Good morning, everybody. It is Monday, February 22nd, and this is our morning drive live. So, quite a bit of discussion over the weekend in the group about treating employees who have dental insurance. And I want to revisit this. We actually had talked about this in week one of the drive lives back on like January 5th or 6th, but wanted to revisit this because we've had a ton of new members since then, and because there's been a lot of discussion about it. So let's talk about treating and billing employees who have dental insurance. First thing we need to remember is treating patients of the same category or class differently because they have insurance is completely illegal. Okay, you cannot bill insurance companies $1,000 for a crown, but bill cash patients $800 for a crown. So how does that affect employees with insurance? If you do Profi's exams and bite wings for all employees for free, no charge, but you have an employee with dental insurance and you submit a claim with a $200 fee for the Profi exam and bite wings and you get paid by insurance, you have overbilled the insurance company. Because employees receive free Profi's exams and x-rays at your office. So by submitting a full fee claim to the insurance company, you've overbilled the insurance company. You're not allowed to do that. Employees get them for free, which means insured employees get them for free. That's the way it works. Which means the insurance company doesn't get billed. So free is free. If you charge zero, then you have to charge $0. Not we'll take what insurance pays. That's overbilling. So look at it this way. You know, what you have to remember when it comes to overbilling, insurance is insurance. Dental insurance is insurance. So it's the same as an auto insurance policy. So let's say there's a body shop in town who charges on a normal day, if you walk in and you say, hey, I want my car painted, I want this done, it's not going to insurance, and they say, well, our shop rate is $75 an hour. Great. But now I walk in and I say, my car was damaged, it was an accident, my auto insurance is paying. And they say, great, our shop rate is $150 per hour. That would be illegal. It's illegal for them to do that because they're charging more because a person is covered by an insurance plan. It's the same thing with dental insurance. You cannot charge someone more because they are covered by insurance. That is the very definition of overbilling. And it is illegal. It is a form of insurance fraud, and it's illegal. So how do we do this? How do we deal with employees with insurance? Well, number one, if an uninsured employee does not pay for something, then you should not be billing their insurance any more than $0 for that service. Yes, if you're in network, you have to submit the claim, but you submit it as a $0 fee, just like the Profi's exams, bite wings example we just talked about. So now what if your office has a policy that the work is done for free, but if an employee needs a crown, they pay the lab fee. So it's a $200 lab fee for that crown. And that's what the employees pay. The employees with no insurance pay $200 for their crown for the lab fee. Then when you do a crown on an insured employee, that $200 is the amount that you submit on the claim form for that crown. So if the employee has 50% coverage, you're submitting it at 200. The employee's gonna pay 100 and the insurance company's gonna pay 100 with deductible not included in the calculation for ease of calculation. So that's the way it works. That is the benefit for an employee who has dental insurance. Any chargeable items, they're gonna pay based on the allowance or the percentage covered with their insurance plan. So a lot of people will say, well, then why do my employees even have dental insurance? I don't know. You know, in the vast majority of offices, dental care for employees is free. There's no charge for it. You know, yes, they may pay some lab bills or something else, but if you're doing a filling or a cleaning or a prophy or so on and so forth, none of that is getting charged to the patient. So one way around it is to have a very clear definition of what and how much is covered in your office. So, you know, when I'm working with offices, we typically will create an employee plan that will cover $1,000 or $1,500 a year worth of work. Anything over that, the employee is responsible. That way, once the employee hits that $1,000 annual maximum for the employee plan, everything over that gets billed to insurance, just like an uninsured employee. Everything over that $1,000, the employee is going to pay. That would be when the insurance kicks in, when they start making payments, and when it becomes billable. So, you know, the important thing to remember is you cannot treat people differently if they are in the same class. So they're in the same class, employee to employee. If it's free for one, it has to be free for all, even those with insurance. That's the way it works. Anything outside of that is overbilling. If there's any questions, post them in the comment section. I will answer them. You know, I'm trying to find an easy calculation, an easy spreadsheet to go over this and just kind of put it out there so everybody understands. So I am here. Have a great day. Hopefully that answered some questions. I will see you guys tomorrow. Have a wonderful day. Good morning, everybody. It is Tuesday, February 23rd, and this is our morning drive live. So, today, I want to talk about something not off topic, but not specific to billing either, which is staying up to date. There's a lot of information, a lot of things that happen that change in a dental office, and you know, it's important that we all stay up to date on everything current. So, a couple examples of what I'm talking about. Somebody asked in the group yesterday, what code do you use for fluoride? And I deleted all of the wrong answers because I don't want there to be any confusion. But people were quoting codes that were done away with 5, 6, 7, 8 years ago, which tells me those offices have not stayed up to date on the current codes. So, you know, a couple things that it is super important for people to stay up to date on would be number one, and this is without a doubt the number one most important thing, the CDT codes. Staying current on the CDT codes is very, very important. No, we saw tons of offices after the occlusal guard code change a couple years ago. Tons of offices not getting paid for occlusal guards. And people emailing me and calling me and texting me saying, we're not getting paid for occlusal guards. What's going on? Why are we not getting paid for this? To which I would reply, what code are you billing? 9940. Well, it changed. It changed as of January 1. You're not going to get paid if you submit 9940. It's not the insurance company's job to update you on the codes. It's our job to stay up to date on those. So now, I'm not suggesting that you rush out every year and buy a brand new CDT code book, but every other year, absolutely. And then insert one of the update forms. You know, we have on our resources page, if you go to practicemechanic.com, click on resources on the upper right hand side, we have the 2021 CDT code updates there. So, you know, download that, buy a book every other year, the off years, get the updates from somewhere. Delta Dental pushes them out. You know, there's a tons of places where you can get what the updated codes are for the in-between years, the deletions, the revisions, the additions, and put that in the book just so you have it, so you stay up to date on the CDT codes. So that's number one. That is super important. You know, 1203 for fluoride, done away with a long time ago. There is no more adult fluoride or children's fluoride code. It is now 1206 is fluoride varnish. 1208 is everything else. Gel, foam, rinse, that's all 1208. And those codes are used regardless of age. So there is no more adult fluoride, kids fluoride. Those codes don't exist. So, you know, staying up to date on the CDT codes is super important. The second thing that is also very important to stay up to date on is the provider manuals. So I've been slowly uploading these into the group files just because I don't want to inundate everybody with them, because when they get posted, they always generate a lot of comments and questions. But staying up to date with the provider manuals is very, very important. You know, Delta added some clauses this year. They will only accept copies, screenshots of clinical chart notes as narratives. That's a big change that happened for 2021. There's no more the front desk writing a separate narrative for a claim submission. They want a screenshot or a copy of the clinical chart note. That's in the provider manual. You know, information on Cigna. Cigna does not allow upcharges if it is a material upgrade. So, you know, if a patient comes to you and says, I want a full gold crown, you would bill a high noble crown. And then a lot of offices, and I would tell them to do it, will add an upcharge or a lab charge for the full gold, the solid gold crown. Cigna's provider manual does not allow you to do that if you're in network. You know, there's a lot of changes with that. These things update constantly. The insurance companies are constantly changing the rules. And I truly believe that if we're gonna win the game, we have to know how to play. And part of knowing how to play is knowing the rules. So we have to stay up to date on that information. You know, so again, Cigna does not allow upgrades for lab materials, even if there's a significant material difference. If a 2740 is a 2740, no matter what material you use, whether you use a Bruxier or an Emax, or you know, some super aesthetic, pleasing ceramic. It doesn't matter. It's a 2740. And if you're in network with Cigna, their contract specifically excludes you from being able to charge upgrade charges for those very specific things. They do allow upgrades for other things like Invisalign or clear or ceramic brackets on orthodontics. But, you know, there are other things like the use of a laser during a perio maintenance or during an SRP that is not separately chargeable. You can't upcharge a laser for a Cigna patient. It's included in the service code. So, you know, these are things to be aware of. You have to watch those. So, the big two things to summarize here. The two most important things to stay up to date on. The CDT codes. Every practice management software has a utility that you can run that will update your CDT codes. Run that update every year. Number two, the provider manuals from the insurance companies are super important to stay up to date with. They are, you know, the biggest thing that tells us how we can deal with insurance, what we can bill, what's inclusive, what's not, what each insurance company considers each thing. So they're the two big things. If you do nothing else, no other updates, stay up to date on those two things, because those are the two things that affect how we get paid. So that is it. I am here. Everybody have a great day, and I will see you tomorrow. Gonna take you down, deep down to the front line. Deep down. You woke up this morning, got yourself a gun. Your mama always said you'd be the chosen one. She said you're one in a million, you got to burn the shine. Morning, everybody. It is Wednesday, February 24th, and this is our morning drive live. So today I kind of want to do a quick little hodgepodge of a couple topics that have come up that are actually quick answers and quick responses. So first of all, there's a lot of discussion going on about what do we have to do to notify the insurance we want to go out of network? How far in advance do we do that? Can we get a letter? Is there samples? Lots of questions about that. And, you know, here is what I will tell everybody now. The contract that your doctor signed with that insurance company is just like any other legally binding document. It is a contract just like any other written contract. So what that means is, in order to know how to hold up your end of the deal, you need a copy of that contract. So rummage through your office, I would be willing to bet somewhere, for most of you, somewhere those contracts are stashed in a drawer or stuffed in a cabinet, or they're somewhere around. If they are not, call the insurance company provider relations department and request a copy of your contract. They will have it. They will have it on file, and they will send it to you. Don't call customer service. Call provider relations and get a copy of that contract. They will send it to you. They will give it to you. It's there. But the answer to most of the questions regarding these type of things, how far in advance do we have to give notice? Do we have to notify patients? What is the process? How do we do it? What should we say? The answers to all of those questions lie within the contract. So, you know, hopefully when your doctor signed them, they kept copies of them. But if not, call provider relations and request a copy of your office's signed contract. Now, yes, there could be changes to it. The insurance companies, part of the contract is the insurance companies have the right to make amendments to the contract and changes to the provider requirements with proper notice, which again, that will be defined in the contract as well. However, these are things you want to know. Talking about being able to charge a dentist, being able to charge an immediate family member. This is something that will be in the contract. A lot of contracts state right in them that the dentist may not submit claims for immediate family, father, mother, parents, siblings, dependents, aunts, uncles, nephews, nieces, and all in-law versions of same. Most contracts have a clause in there that prohibits you from even submitting the claim for patients that fall into that category. That will be in the contract. Processing guidelines. When something gets paid, how much time you have to submit the claim, that will be in the contract. So, you know, read the contracts. It's very well defined. Believe me, those insurance companies have incredibly well-paid lawyers who write those contracts that leave very little open-ended. There's very little left to the imagination when you actually read one of the contracts. So one of the other things that the contracts will say is that processing, claims processing, you know, attachment requirements are defined in the provider manual. We have started uploading provider manual into the group folder. Into the group files, and we're gonna add one every day or so. So we'll continue to build that library. But right now, the Cigna PPO provider manual and the Delta Dental National provider manual are both in the group files. Today, I will be uploading the Cigna HMO provider manual. So that will be uploaded into the group files today for those of you who are in network, work with the Cigna HMOs. That provider manual will be uploaded today. So you need to look at the two different documents, but between the two of them, they will give you all the information that you need in order to successfully process claims with them, to understand the contract requirements. And yes, the contract will even tell you how to go out of network. So that is something that, you know, everybody should have a copy of their contract. Again, I've said it five times, I'll say it one more. If you don't have it, call them and get a copy. Don't call customer service, call provider relations. If you know who your rep is for that insurance company, call your rep. They will be able to get you a copy of your signed contract. You know, there are even things in the contract. Some insurance companies, United, Concordia, you're the best one at this. Some insurance companies are even good at having a clause in the contract that says your state may follow the never ever rule for non-covered services. However, by signing this contract and initialing the last page, you waive that right and agree to charge all United Concordia patients the allowed fee, even for non-covered services. So that's something that is in the contract. So if you do it and you signed the contract and you initialed accepting that clause, which most people do without even thinking about it, especially now, because, you know, contracts are done through DocuSign or through some online process where it just, you know, initial next, and very few people actually read them. So, you know, make sure you are reading them, because they're sliding that clause in there. And, you know, the associations and dentists have fought so hard to get those non-covered services rules passed so that we can charge our full fee for services that are truly non-covered services. But then the insurance companies slide that clause in there that you can opt out of, but it's still in there. You still agree to it. So in the meantime, you've agreed to it. So now all non-covered services, you're going to be charging the allowed fee instead of your full fee because you've agreed to it in the contract. So, you know, like I said, call your rep, call provider relations, get copies of your contracts, read them, know what they say, and you'll be set. I am here. Everybody have a great day. I will see you tomorrow. Good morning, everybody. It is February 25th, and this is our morning drive live. So, today I want to talk about refusals. Patient refusals, you know, specifically when it comes to periodontal disease, scaling and root planings versus prophes, so on and so forth. Seen a lot of posts, a lot of talk, a lot of opinions on what to do if a patient refuses scaling and root planing. What do we do if a patient just says they want their regular cleaning? And, you know, I'm going to throw my opinion out there. And that's what it is, because I truly believe this is an office-to-office discussion. This is something that your office needs to decide its own protocol on. But I want to give my opinion on that. So, you know, I understand a lot of offices say, if you are a perio patient, if you need scaling and root planing, we absolutely refuse to do a prophy on you. Fine. Totally get it. Absolutely, you're right. 100%. But, you know, a patient refusing scaling and root planing in lieu of a prophy and a patient refusing x-rays are two totally different things. A lot of people will say, well, you know, it's supervised neglect. Supervised neglect is when the patient removes your ability to diagnose and you still continue to treat them. If I go into the emergency room and I say my arm hurts, and they say, well, we're gonna take an x-ray, and I say no, I've removed the doctor's ability to diagnose what's wrong with me, so they can't determine a course of treatment. So refusing x-rays is a big no-no. However, if they take the x-ray and they tell me you have a broken arm, and I say, absolutely no cast, we're not putting a cast on, I don't want a cast, there is no way I'm gonna do a cast, they will not throw me out of the emergency room. They will find another solution. So, how does that relate to dentistry? If a patient absolutely refuses x-rays, 100% you have removed the doctor's ability to properly diagnose, get rid of them. 100% agree, because that's my diagnosis. I can't make an accurate one. I am neglectful in my duties if I can't get an x-ray. However, if you get the x-rays, you take the FMX, doctor does the exam, and you diagnose the patient as having periodontal disease, and they say, I don't want the scaling and root plating, I just want a prophy. There's a big difference there. You know, you can have the patient sign consent forms, you can have the patient sign refusal forms. Will any of that hold up in court? You know, who knows? I mean, there's very few cases that have been brought to a courtroom over this, and the vast majority of them happen or result in a negative outcome for the dentist when the dentist didn't diagnose perio and there was active perio, or the dentist didn't explain to the patient the possible outcomes of not treating it. But doing a prophy on a patient that had a scaling and root plate, that needed scaling and root planing, after you've discussed with them all of the possible negative and positive outcomes, which is what a consent form is, that covers 99.9% of the court cases. So, you know, there's a huge difference there. Another way to look at this, and, you know, I see people who train dentists and their teams on how to properly present treatment plans. And they will say, we're going to use, a lot of them, use the good, better, best system, which means this patient ultimately needs to replace a tooth. So we can do it with a removable partial, we can do it with a bridge, or we can do it with an implant abutment and implant crown. You're giving the patient options on how to treat their own health, their own mouth. It's really the same thing when you're talking about periodontal disease. You know, you can give them options and say, listen, the absolute least you can do, this is the worst thing you can do, here are the possible negative outcomes, here are the possible positive outcomes for a prophy. That is the absolute least you can do. It is not going to assist in treating the disease. Be upfront with them, explain it to them. Now, the next thing we can do is a scaling and root plating. And then the last thing would be we could refer you to a periodontist, and you know, they'll want to take out all of your teeth and replace them all with implants. That's the process. But if we're going to do good, better, best that on the restorative side, then that's our office policy. Good, better, best. Prophy's good. Scaling and root plating is better. So on and so forth. That's the way to do it. You know, I see so many dentists posting, oh, you know, I did this patient, they really needed a crown 2 years ago, but he didn't have the money, so I just did a huge four surface filling thinking it would get him through. Well, it's been 18 months and now the patient needs a crown, but insurance isn't going to pay for it because there's been a restoration on the tooth within the past 24 months, blah, 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 blah. They did that. They did a prophy instead of scaling and root planing. They did a filling when the patient really needed a crown. So, you know, don't look at it as there being this huge difference, or if a patient refuses scaling and root planing, we evict them from the office. If that's what your office does, that's fine. But if you're doing that for patients who need scaling and root planing and only want a prophy because that's what they can afford, you should also be doing that for patients who need a crown but only want a filling because that's what they can afford. It's the same exact thing. So, you know, something to just keep in mind. Again, you know, lost malpractice cases, lost cases of supervised neglect are because of either A, the patient was never explained the differences. The patient was never explained the possible negative outcomes. They were told, well, you need a deep cleaning and blah, 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 blah. They were never properly explained. Or the dentist continued to treat a patient without the ability to diagnose, which means exams, x-rays, so on and so forth. They're the big issues. So, you know, don't look at refusals as always a negative thing. Absolutely consult with your malpractice carrier. That is what I will say. I refer to malpractice carriers all the time because they are the ones who are going to be charged with defending you if one of these cases pops up. So, you know, defer to them. Ask them for refusal forms. Chances are they won't give you a refusal form because you don't really need a refusal form. You need proper documentation that you diagnosed and properly presented all possible courses of treatment to that patient. So that is it. I'm sure this one's going to generate a lot of talk. Again, remember, this is something that you determine office to office to office. So, you know, if one office decides we're only going to do the best courses of treatment for our patients, we're going to do the number one most ideal thing, and that is it, we're going to do nothing other than ideal, then that's fine. That's your office policy. If another office says we're going to present good, better, best, that's fine too. This is office to office. So determine what your policy is and make it a office-wide, a practice-wide policy, and you'll be good to go. I am here. Everybody have a great day, and I will see you tomorrow. Good morning, everybody. It is Friday, February 26th, and this is our morning drive live. So, we've gotten a lot of new members in the group over the past few weeks, and a question that I'm still seeing over and over again is talking about discounting. Talking about discounting for uninsured patients, talking about discounting for insured patients. And I wanted to do kind of a discount compilation video to cover a couple different topics. So, number one, when we talk about discounting, one thing you have to remember: the amount that you submit on the claim form is supposed to be the amount you intend to collect without regard to any negotiated discount. What that means is if a patient has insurance and you are in network, if your normal fee, your office UCR, is $1,000 for a crown, and you are in network with Delta, who allows $700, you don't submit the $700 on the crown because you intend to collect $1,000. That $1,000 is made up from three things. Number one, what insurance will pay. Number two, what the patient will pay. And number three, your negotiated discount. That is allowed, and that is the way it's supposed to be. So, you know, if you charge $1,000 for a crown, you submit $1,000 on the claim form. Between the negotiated discount, $300 write-off, 50% coverage, so $350 from insurance, $350 from patient. That is a normal claim. That is the normal way we process them. That is totally and completely fine and acceptable, because between those three sources, you collected your full $1,000. Because remember, the negotiated discount is a contractual requirement, so it counts. Here is where we run into issues. When people say, well, I charge $1,000 for a crown for an insured patient, but if a patient doesn't have insurance, I only charge $900. That is overbilling. You are not allowed to charge an insured patient differently than an uninsured patient. And that's where we run into the issue. So if your uninsured patients pay $900 for a crown, and you're submitting $1,000 on the claim form, you are overbilling the insurance companies, because you're making it look like your normal fee for uninsured patients is $1,000 when it's actually $900. So the exception to this would be if you have an in-house discount dental plan. That is also considered a contractual adjustment. So just like somebody with insurance that you're in network with and there's a write-off, an in-house discount plan that a member pays to be a member of, remember, that's what makes it a valid contract. There has to be an exchange of goods or services or money to be a valid contract. So if it is a valid contract, which in most states an in-house discount dental plan is, there are some states like Washington State where they are illegal. They can't exist. But you know, in the other states, the vast majority of states, you're allowed to do that as long as it's a valid contract, which means the patient pays to be a member of that group, of that discount plan that has a contractually negotiated discount. That's fine. You're still good. So, you know, a lot of confusion on that, it seems. The issue here is, and remember, this is kind of a compilation of different discount subjects. The issue is, in all 50 states, it is a criminal act to represent to an insurance company that the fee on the claim form is actually more than what it should be. And this doesn't just apply to dental insurance. It applies to all insurances, whether it's homeowners, automotive, dental, you know, workers' comp. It applies to all insurance companies. If your auto body shop, you get rear-ended, you know, my son just got rear-ended in his car a couple weeks ago, took it to the auto body shop. The auto body shop sent the estimate to the insurance company, said it's going to cost this much money. Insurance company said, okay, do the work. We'll pay the bill, no problem. If the insurance company had received a claim from the auto body shop or an estimate, and the estimate said, well, it's going to cost $5,000 to fix this car, and the insurance company said, okay, great, go ahead and bill it. Do the work, send us the bill, we'll pay it. And then they did the work and it was only $4,000, but they still sent the claim for $5,000. That's overbilling. You know, so this isn't something that is dental specific. It is insurance law. It is criminal statutes in all 50 states. Overbilling any insurance company is illegal. It's not just specific to dental. And, you know, I hear all the time, yesterday in my group and in, you know, the one other group that I'm very active in, the ADOM group, people would say, well, show me where it says the law. Show me where it says it applies to dentists. It doesn't work that way. I would have to show you where it says it doesn't apply to dentists. It applies to all businesses, all entities within the state. You are an entity, you are a business, you are a person within the state, so the rule applies to you. You know, it doesn't have to specifically say this includes dentists. It just, if it says it excludes dentists, that's different. But it doesn't have to say it includes dentists. That would be like me robbing a bank, and then when somebody says, well, you robbed a bank, me saying, well, show me in the law where it says it applies to people named Richard. Because I don't see that written in the law that it applies to people named Richard. It just says you can't do it. It doesn't say Richards can't do it. It's the same thing. The other thing when we talk about discounting, and this was just a post this morning in the ADOM group, was, people using the HIPAA non-disclosure restriction as a way to not discount, but do the opposite and collect full fee. The issue is, somebody this morning had an oral surgeon who had a patient sign a HIPAA non-disclosure for implant placement, placed the implants, collected their full fee because the patient signed a HIPAA non-disclosure. But now the patient went back to the general dentist. The general dentist submitted the claim for the crown and the abutment. And guess what? Insurance said, we have no record of an implant being placed there. Please send us the dates of service. The general dentist can do that, but they don't know the dates of service because it's restricted. The oral surgeon's not even allowed to send an x-ray, chart notes, the date of service, anything for that implant, even to the referring dentist. So now the patient has an implant that they paid full fee for that they can't get their insurance to cover the crown and the abutment because the insurance has no record of that being ever done. And, nor will they because it's been restricted under HIPAA. If that oral surgeon is in network, they're going to have to have the patient unrestrict the information, which they can do, then submit it. Then they're going to owe the patient a big refund because now the allowed fees are going to come into effect, not the full fee that oral surgeon wanted to collect. So, that's again kind of the opposite of a discount, is a way to get your full fee. But I hate HIPAA disclosure restrictions. Yes, they're there. Yes, they're legal. But this is one of the things that happens when people use them to try and find a workaround for their contract to get their full fee. So, talk about that. Any questions about discounts, post them in the group. We are all learning together, and it's super important that we work together to get this figured out. Because it's things that apply to all of us across the board. So I am here. It is Friday. Everybody have a fantastic weekend, and I will see you guys on Monday morning. Gonna take you down.